two then, can members turn to page 15 of the agenda, where you'll find the minutes of the last meeting and the action tracker. First, we'll look at the minutes. Are there any issues arising from the minutes? Councillor Gibbon?
Just for the information of members, two new issues have arisen after the concerns I expressed over the mutual ideas company. So, for courtesy,
which minute are you referring to?
I'm referring
on page
two, chair's update, slash day back in
on the airport.
I've read to Rebecca as head of audit that there's now the existence of a third car park has come to light at Wynn Street, and there are questions about the funding of companies that are in Salford. So I wanted to raise these for a future audit for scrutiny.
Thank you, Councillor, and I can acknowledge that we have received those concerns and that we'll be looking at them. How we report back will be through the audit progress report, Councillor, but to yourself in the first instance, but it is on our list to do, so take some charge from that, please.
Thank you. Any other issues in relation to minutes? And we can do it briefly. Okay, turning to the action tracker then, which is on page 22. Members recall this is something relatively new that we're doing. As issues are dealt with, they'll be removed from the action tracker that the items are from the here. Are there any issues in relation to the action tracker?
Examinations have not yet been done with some officers and fuel issues and non-compliance or power.
item four then, the quality risk management update, notice of return to page 54, which asks the committee to know the contents of the report. I'm going to ask Gareth Lewis to introduce the report. Just for members' benefits, I think there are a range of officers here that some members might not know, so perhaps you could just do a quick introduction, please, about your role.
Yes, I'm Gareth Lewis. I'm one of the
Surely, not after all these years. Thank you, Chair. It's interesting, thank you, and good to meet you. I suppose one of the questions I asked the commissioners at the last meeting, and if we refer to, I'm looking at page 56 in the report, item 2.6 and 2.7 talks about corporate risk register, and I asked the lead commissioner at the time a question, and I'm going to ask you the same question. As a member of this audit committee, can you give me and this committee assurance as of today that a similar debacle, catastrophe, whichever adjective you wish to pick, that has happened over the energy contract could not happen right now? Have you been able to put the right checks and balances into procedure that you can give us the assurance that that couldn't happen now?
It's not my specific role in terms
Chair's permission, I'd just like to tease out a little while I accept, as Chief Exec responsibility, I accept that you're here presenting the paper which talks about risk. I'd like to know whether this city is still at risk because of our procedures and other places. In your opinion, you just come to present, I'm not trying to be out, simply assessing what those are risks as of here now. I think what, without trying to put words in your mouth, it's a work in progress, and that's what I'm looking for, the assurance that while we may not be there yet, we're on that journey, and you're confident that we'll get into that part of the journey, which is actually what I'm looking for to be able to
Thank you, Councillor.
I'll
take that.
Councillor Simon.
Yeah, I think in relation to that, that's partly answered what I was going to ask, but I mean, I think one of the concerns, certainly from the massage report and other reports that came back here and to other committees and to full council over the whole issues surrounding that energy contract was the fact that it wasn't escalated up. And I suppose the assurances that Councillor Mitchell, myself, and others will be wanting to have is that even at the lowest level, there's some form of smaller contract management, that those before, it might not be something that comes up as a corporate risk, and it could escalate perhaps by the end of the contract when suddenly, you know, that part of that was, you know, the closing the desk on those things and the significant risk, even though it was well known there would be risk around energy costs were there. So I think it's twofold in us being clear about how that's being managed at a lower level in the organisation and how it's being flagged up to elected members, because that was another issue. There was a lot of criticism around elected members when in fact it hadn't been flagged to them at an early stage.
You're absolutely right, Councillor, and that's what this committee's here to do, isn't it? It's to seek assurance, and that's what you're doing. I think I can give you a bit of comfort on that. It's the next item, I should segue in, but the audit plan. So we've got strategic procurements, we've got commissioning on there, so you're going to get that assurance via the internal audit plan, that audit work that's done. Also, I think for January's committee, the procurement report, I think it's come through to yourselves as well. So the 4Cs report, so that's an independent commission review, should come through to the committee, so they'll have an opportunity again just to scrutinise that and just to ensure that those controls are in place, to ensure that our commissioning and procurement arrangements are sound, robust, and we don't have any nasty surprises, because that's what it's all about, really. These things do come out of these guys, you know, and we can't say hand on heart that this sort of thing won't happen again. But what we can do is put as many controls and measures in place to give you that assurance that it's identified and dealt with as quickly as it can be.
Thanks. Rowan Johnson.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I think I can't speak for everyone here to say that it is good to see this this corporate risk register in place after a lot of the recent matters that have happened in the past. But I do think that just an observation with what's shown here, we've got current scores and target scores, and it seems that every risk is targeted to reach a green level, even though they're in the deepest of red, but there's not really a clear showing of what the mitigation measures are. There's a lot in there in terms of assurance, but in terms of outside of the assurance, what are the things that are happening outside of the assurance to move it all to that green? Because I know, is the green just an aspiration, or is it an actual target with some science behind it?
Thanks for that, Ramon. So in terms of the target scores, they need to really be set with an appetite, and an appetite statement is something that we'll be setting out within our next iteration of the risk policy. We've had a bit of discussion at CMT in terms of scores, but I think there's still some refinement to do. You'll see that all current and inherent scores are at red, which I think was CMT's feeling, that let's have them escalating as high as they can be. So I do think there's some further refinements to do in terms of scores, but at the moment, as it's in its infancy as a register, it probably makes sense to be more risk averse than not, I guess. So I think there'll be some work to do in terms of target scores, as I say, to put them within an appetite, and that's certainly something that we're working on to do. I've just forgotten your last question.
It was around the mitigation items.
Mitigation.
So how do we from current scores to target score outside of the assurance?
No, absolutely. There's a couple of schools of thought that say that in three lines of defence are actually your mitigation. So actually when I'm putting in, or we're putting in sort of three lines, that those are actually the mitigations. We could have a separate column for mitigations if it would make more sense in terms of risk management. It's something we can think about. What I don't want to do is make this an over busy register, if that makes sense, because it needs to be almost as a dashboard format.
I agree with that. We could catch both separately if need to be, but I think keep it simple in terms of the dashboard. It's more about what sits behind it in that point. But yeah, we can catch up that separately.
Sounds
right. Sam, did you have a point in relation to that?
Yeah. I think it's really important as well that we don't have the information behind it to really distinguish between what we can mitigate against as a council, so things that are down to our own risks and our own systems, and things that are outside of our control. You know, if you look at some of the safeguards and stuff in relation to children and recruitment, that's a real national issue, that's not just something that's, you know, bespoke to Liverpool. So it's about sort of saying, right, what are we doing to try and do the best? Perhaps what are we doing with our city region partners and the Northern, etc. But actually distinction, because when we're looking at our own improvement journey, some things sometimes are outside of our actual control to get to that green thing. And I think just that stage, if we're going to be having this every quarter or very difficult to do that. And now I kind of looking at things that you say over and over again, thinking, you know, we've got an action plan, but realistic targets that we're expected to achieve in 1 month, 6 months, 8 months, 12 months. And then if we're not achieving them, look at the barriers that's stopping them happening so we can deal with it rather than it just remaining that big risk.
Spot on, Councillor. Absolutely.
Thank you. Councillor Gibbons.
Yeah, as usual, I can't let this go. It might not be a strictly audit issue without saying yet again that schools who did nothing wrong are still picking up the tab, potentially, for the mistake, these historic mistakes. And I think we've 8 months now. I can remember sitting in Radio Merseyside to do an interview straight after Councillor Corbett. 8 months, I mean, in my world, you hold your hand up for a mistake and you do something about it. And I don't think there's any improvement journey in this council until schools are absolutely secure they don't pay a penny for the mistakes of this council. And I think it's a disgrace that this has not been resolved yet.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments from members? Okay. Can I move that your recommendation be approved? Is that agreed? Item number five then, the refreshed audit plan and delivery model, it's already been touched on. Councillor Rebecca Neill to introduce the report, which is on page 64 onwards.
Thank you, Chair, it would be a pleasure. I'll take the report as read and draw out the key points you find in May. Essentially, there are two parts for the committee to approve in this report. Recommended delivery model for internal audit and also a refreshed audit plan for the remainder of the financial year. So, I think first it's useful to set some context for you all. It'll be no surprise to the committee that internal audit has attracted some criticism of late. Commissioner's second report, Bristol Peer Review, as was mentioned earlier, and obviously more recently the Mazars Energy Contract Review. The service has some capacity issues, as again, another committee is well versed in. We've got 6 out of 17 post vacant at the minute. And obviously there's also been an increased demand on airtime from responsive audit work, responsive whistleblowers and other concerns that have been raised with us. Members will remember the Commission's second report recommending that a new operating model for the service needs urgent design and agreement. So in essence, that's what the first part of this report is. So, if members turn to section 2 of the report, where are we? Page 69. This sets out an assessment of the usual models of audit service delivery, together with their pros and cons, assessed against the criteria of innovation, flexibility and VFM. Now, you'll see that the report recommends the co-source model, which is what we have as our current delivery model. This allows us the benefits of the commitment and ownership of an in-house team, together with the ability to bring in that innovation of specialists or capacity as and when we require them. Currently that's delivered to us by SWOP, who are our audit provider on that. It's a less resource intensive recommendation to implement, and that together with the other transformation improvement activity that the audit team are undertaking at the minute allows us to get to a steady state until the new director of audit arrives and also the new section 151. So in essence, I'm not going to recommend anything that is totally transformational at this stage because obviously we've got a new leadership that's coming in. So I'll pause and take any comments or questions on that. So co-sourced, I think, is the model and my preferred recommendation for yourselves. But I'll pause there before I move on to the delivery. terms of innovation and all the rest of it. I think this is just in terms of the theory is, but often in practical and real sense it may not always be the case. But so far I'm quietly optimistic, but I'll sprinkle a little bit of holy water on that because I don't want to jinx this. I think that we're going to be in a position that certainly for the new financial year, when your new audit plan for 23-24 comes to you, you'll have the complement of staff that you need to deliver it. That's my plan.
Okay, thank you. And does any members have any questions on the delivery model before we move on to the second part of the report? Steve.
Thank you. Rebecca, just could you give us a bit of insight into who SWAP are, and importantly, whether you believe they've got the capacity to help if we actually need to call them?
Certainly, so SWAP. We are currently contracted with SWAP to provide that top up service for us. They're the South West Audit Partnership, but like to be referred to as SWAP. So there, I'll turn to Mel at this point, because she's got a little bit more detail on the than I have. But there, I think they're a joint, various local authorities are joined together, so it's like a conjoint type authority organisation. In terms of the procurements that we did with them, great in terms of cost and quality, and I have to say in terms of the service that they've been delivering for us, they've been very responsive. And the quality is being spot on. So I haven't got any problems with them. What we will plan to do is do another procurement exercise so that we do have that top up going forward, as this was just really for this financial year. So, that's all I can really say about them. I can give you a little bit more detail on them if you'd like separately, but so far, delivering for us, and as I say, I've been very responsive.
No, I've seen some of that according to the book, because it may well be if we don't get those vacancies, we need to call them. So they've got the capacity, that's right.
Yeah, in terms of capacity, it was a conversation that I had with them about a month ago. Clearly, as with all audit sections, everyone starts to panic in the last quarter of the financial year to get that audit plan complete, but they're giving us the assurances that they can meet our demands for now. I'll move on to the second aspect of the report, and then I think there is just there's a slight area that we need to think about. I'll go into that now if I can.
Any other questions on this part of the report? Okay, you want to move on.
Right, thank you, Chair. So the second part of the report, section 3, that's a refresh audit plan. So that includes a review of where we are in terms of capacity and number of auditors that we have now. We've done that comparison with other core cities, so we know that we're about average, we're not unusual, which is good, it's where we want to be. Committee may recall that the Bristol peer review recommended that the audit plan needed more explicit links to risk. This plan achieves that with links to the new risk register that we've just heard about. The plan also, this is more important for yourselves, I guess, in terms of that assurance piece again that we're talking about tonight. Also restarts the core financial systems audits, puts in place an IT audit programme, and also starts a source audit programme again. So these are all things that we need to give us that assurance. Programme delivers 50 planned audits in total. As it stands there, that's with the auditors that we have in post currently. Which is a significant improvement on previous years where I think we've delivered two in the last 2021 and 21-22 respectively. And that's not to say that the audit section in that time were busy doing nothing. There were other things that they were up to in terms of providing evidence, etc. to various police inquiries that, again, I know the committee were all well rehearsed in. So what we're doing is resetting this, so that we're getting that planned audit work coming across the line, which is exactly where we want to be and exactly where the Commission wants to be as well. Quite right, Steve, as we just mentioned, with the six vacant posts that we've got, to make us commensurate with others, those posts would have to be actively filled, people in positions. If we were going to buy that resource in, that I've said in the report that we need to have a think about in consultation with Section 151. Yourselves, we welcome your view, and the chair of the committee obviously as well. I think with the delivery of, obviously there's a financial consequence attached to that, my professional opinion, which is what you're paying for, is that if we can get 50 audits across the line, and you'll see from the progress report that we'll be coming to, we're giving you that assurance that we can, and I'm looking across at Ben Gareth as well at that point, no pressure, that if we can do that, it will give me sufficient to enable the audit opinion at the year end, and it will also provide you with the assurances that you will need to. So I will pause for breath there.
Questions from members? Councillor Simon.
Yeah, just related to the interviews that you said are taking place today, how will that reduce the cost as we, across the year, fill those posts? Because obviously, you're calculating that there's a significant amount of increase in funding, isn't it? And not that expertise staying within the authority as well, because that's the other issue, isn't it? That you bring people in and those skills aren't necessarily transferred to others, is it, coming in via spot purchase, you know, across a period of time. So I just wondered if you've done any figures around, you know, if your recruitment today was successful. I don't know how many candidates you're expecting to see from that over a period of time, actually how that figure will begin to reduce, and we would get those skilled people that we need to actually be permanent and committed to the organisation overall.
Absolutely, Councillor. It's just what's really annoying to me, it's notice periods. It would be lovely if we could get them in straight away and hit the ground running and all the rest of it, but I'm just wary that it's Christmas and then usually auditors are working on 2 months, kind of 3 months notice periods and current employment and the rest. So I don't think we're going to solve it immediately. So what that would do would reduce the need to go out to swap if we had them in post immediately. But I think how I see this rolling for the rest of the year is that we bring those auditors on board as and when we can, as soon as we can, see if we can negotiate terms with them, if we can try and reduce those notice periods so they come to us earlier, get that induction done really quickly and then get people sort of on the ground and running for us. That is obviously going to take time. I'm going to be happy if we have 50 audits completed by the year end. I'll be really satisfied with that, and I think you all should too. So I guess there's not a straightforward answer. It depends, doesn't it, in terms of when we get them in and how that would impact on how much it would cost us. You know, would we need that 600 days if we've already got half that complement in? That's how it sort of works, really, understanding the financial position councillors at the moment, and I know very much from Ian, you know, that we need to be absolutely all over this. So I think it's a watch this space. You'll have another progress report, I think either in January or it could come in, I think January, March meetings are next. So we'll be able to have an update anyway in terms of where we are against that.
And just secondary to that, in respect to those 50 audits, the prioritisation of them as well, in respect of those that are likely to either increase income to the council or save us money through other means in respect of some of those risks. So it just be useful to know how they will be prioritised, and particularly as we're heading up, you know, for that budget period and looking at our budget across the next 3 years, because we need all these things to tie in, don't we?
You absolutely do, Councillor. I mean, in terms of the head of the plan has been put together, it's based on what's called financial strategic risks. So these are the things that we think are going to materially affect us, which we've seen on the risk register today. I have actually set a KPI for audit once, which is to be a no cost to the authority section, but I'm going to like just do that in case they're looking at me at the moment. It does work, because it's part of the audit
And then finally,